Stories from the Heart in Search of Love now on BBC One. Barnardo's Children.
Yes, it's definitely my father. Yeah, he's really lost and lonely. Very sad, really. You just feel for them, and you can see him being asked to smile, to look as if he's happy. And obviously he's not. I think the eyes say it all.
When Susan Cameron recognised her father in the first series of Barnardo's Children 2 years ago, it brought home to her the tragedy of children who had been abandoned. Thomas Barnardo rescued destitute children from the streets. And when he began his mission towards the end of the 19th century, he called them street Arabs and little gutter lads. Early images were carefully shot for fundraising purposes. They easily provoke our sympathy, unlike today's youth.
Life is hard, yeah, very difficult.
The tragedy of these generations of young people is that they are all in search of love. Barnardo still care for children in desperate circumstances. The aim, to give children a new start, remains the same, but the methods of working have transformed. Many people were deeply moved by the first series, especially by the story of Mabel. She grew up here, amongst thousands of others in the Barnardo's purpose-built village. Her memories remain strong, but the details of why she was sent there in the first place have always been vague.
At one stage, we were told that her mother went off and left us, and that he was in the army, you know, in the war. We were told that, but we were never told as to why our mother left us, or where she left us, and who found us.
Not all the children stayed in the orphanages. A policy of fostering was introduced, and by the 1930s, almost half were living with families paid to take care of them. Some were luckier than others.
We were made to work very, very hard, and the foster mother, she used to hit us a lot, and she had a stick that she used to keep in the corner by the fireplace. And, you know, my mind takes me back and I can still see that stick standing there.
Mabel and her twin sister Marjorie were frightened to tell anyone. It was her Sunday school teacher who eventually discovered what was wrong.
She said, "Where does it hurt?" And I said, "My head." And, you know, she parted my hair. My head was a mass of bruises from this hitting with this stick. And then I did tell her why the bruises were there, because I had been repeatedly hit on the head with a stick.
Once Barnardo's discovered the situation, the twins were immediately returned to the village. This is Stepney Causeway in the 1920s, the days when Mabel was still a girl. It was on this street that Thomas Barnardo, a young man of 25, set up his first boys' home in 1873. By the time this film was made, the organisation was looking after 8,000 children throughout the land. The sign outside still read, "No destitute child ever refused admission." Teenage prostitutes and rent boys, drug addicts and the homeless, they all still exist for the Barnardos of today, and the door is still open to them. But they don't hold the attraction of the innocent young orphan. These days, problem children are more likely to raise a cynical eyebrow. than a tear. No one knows this better than Kath Shabinsky, who is on her way to work at the Elms Family Centre near Derby.
My role at the centre is to offer a counselling service to women, adult women, children and young people who have experienced sexual abuse in childhood. Children coming to the centre have a chance in a safe and supportive environment to be able to express their feelings about what's happened to them, to be able to talk about what's happened to them in a way which suits them. To have somebody to listen to that, probably for the very first time. And also to learn to have fun, because when children have been sexually abused, their childhood is taken away. And a lot of them have never experienced any fun, any enjoyment. So one of the things we try to encourage the children is that they can learn that good things can happen in their life. Not everything always has to be bad.
Gemma suffered terribly throughout her childhood at the hands of someone she and her mother trusted implicitly. After a suicide attempt at the age of 11, she was referred to Barnardo's. Here, she uses drawing as a way of expressing her feelings. Now, aged 16, she has begun to retrieve some of the childhood denied to her and regain some confidence in herself.
Okay, finished? Right, well done. So, three different pictures. What have we got? Tell me about what you've got there, Jen.
This one is how I used to feel. I felt like the whole world was on my shoulders. And this one was when I started to feel better. And sometimes when I just don't want to carry on.
Yeah.
And then I want to feel like really happy and just get on with my life like everybody else does.
You've done quite a few drawings over the time you've been coming to see me.
Yep.
And I wondered if you'd like to have a look at them now. Now, this one's a bit hard to see, isn't it? Because it's all on...
black.
Black. And do you remember what why black was so important to you? What did you used to do with it?
You couldn't black. See nothing, and then you didn't have to express your feelings if you couldn't see it.
That's right. And everything you used to do was on black, wasn't it? And you always wore black. Look at you now. You've got your blues on today, yeah? So it's a bit hard to see this one, but can you just about make up what you've put up there, what you wanted to make you feel nice? You might not be able to see that. Yeah, love and cuddles, right? You wanted to feel, have love and cuddles. But you didn't have them very much. Okay. Yeah, remember this one?
Yeah.
Yes. So what have we... Can you work out what you've got there?
When you don't have cuddles, you just feel like nothing. And that's why there's only a dot on that side.
The traditional view of a Barnardo's child is that of the orphan. Though few were really orphans, all were desperate for love, like Frank and Reg True.
We were a family of, or had been, 13 children. When her mother died in 1937, there were 10 of us alive, and the last one died either with or shortly after her. Quite what happened, we don't know, but the four of us were taken to Stepney Causeway and put in the care of Dr. Barnardo's.
Shortly afterwards, Reg and Frank were separated from their sisters and then sent off to meet the woman who was to take the place of their mother.
We get off this train and there was this little old lady who was dressed in black from the top to bottom, and she got a funny old hat on, black. And I remember turning and saying, "Oh, blimey, I don't want to go with her. She only needs a cat and a broomstick and she'd be a witch."
Despite their first impressions, the Trues grew fond of her.
She never, ever attempted to say that, give us the impression she was our mother. She tried to explain in her own way that, you know, our mum had died and that she was looking after us.
She just said that, well, you know I love you, don't you? So I said, yeah. I said, I know you love us, but why? Oh, and no, why she loved us, you see. So she says, because you're you, she said. And then she said, because God wants me to, and I know your mother wants me to. And that's the way you share to me. I mean, she is my mother. She's my living mother. Well, she was then, but she still lives on in my memory, so that's it, you know what I mean?
Memories are precious for Frank and Reg. So too for a young girl from Leeds called Bernadette.
This is a poem I did for my mum's funeral, which I wrote on the day she died. It's called Mum. The wind beneath my wings is taking me away as I leave my family behind today. Peacefully I drifted, no pain did I feel, as I lay useless on the bed when they tell my family I'm dead. We say goodbye to the mum that we loved, but never to the memories that she gave us. Mum, we will always love you, and you will never be forgotten. Always in our hearts, good night and God bless. My mum had asthma and osteoporosis, and she'd been like this for 4 years. 2 years on, she got told she had to have a heart and lung transplant, but doctors said they couldn't do a heart because it'd be a bit too dangerous. I think Mum just lost hope of ever getting better. And hospital social workers said that there was someone she could talk to and that'd help with the children, which was Barnardo's, and that they could go out on outings and go to the castle project itself and mix in with other children, just to make them feel as if they belong somewhere.
In the past, children were encouraged to forget their family. They became part of the Barnardo's family. Now, at the castle project in Leeds, the importance of precious memories has been recognised.
The memory store is a method that we use for helping parents and children come to terms with loss, death and dying. It's used most commonly in situations where a mum or a dad will have some form of terminal illness, and it's about preparing something that the children can have when mum or dad has died. Some of the smaller boxes over here, mothers have used that for putting in things like baby's first tooth when it's come out, maybe the first baby grow, a lock of hair, and a scarf that she used to wear around her neck with the perfume, so that the child would have tangible things to touch. And for anyone coming to terms with the fact that they may be dying is difficult enough, but the thought of actually leaving behind children that they'd hoped they'd be able to rear themselves makes it even more complex and difficult. I've got a particular quote here from one mum who completed the memory store before she died and was leaving it for her daughter. And what she said was, "My daughter is my one joy in a sea of sadness. Someone else will take over my child, but I'm writing a diary about her so she'll know how much I loved her."
Mum died just over a year ago. And then Barnardo's come up with the idea of doing a memory box, putting things in that Mum liked and things that Mum left us, and the things we could remember her by.
It is easy to feel sorry for bereaved children. They are the innocent victims. It is less easy when it comes to the harder edge of Barnardo's work, with young prostitutes. Thomas Barnardo started his charity to rescue vulnerable children from the streets, some of them prostitutes. It says little for society that this work needs to continue in projects like the streets and lanes in Yorkshire. Here, a safe refuge is provided and girls like Sandra and Carol are encouraged to talk about their feelings. It is too dangerous to feature the girls themselves, but their own words are spoken by actresses.
My uncle and another man had sex with me when I was 9. The last 2 years I've been with some real bastards.
Sarah Swan, the project leader, offers counselling and also tries to make the centre feel like a home.
The most used resource is food. So this is the kitchen. Lollipops, sweets. There's something around allowing them to be children because they haven't had those sort of childhood experiences, really. They believe it's their fault that they've brought it on themselves and they've got guilt around that. And one of the ways we work through that is looking at how they actually got involved.
When I was 13, I met a man. He was 24 and drove a taxi. I thought he was lovely. He was willing to wait for sex until I was ready. He told me I needed to work for him and gave me some real beatings. I was really scared. He sat in his car and watched me so I couldn't run away. I got £20, but he took the money.
This project was set up to work with young people who were involved in sexual exploitation, is how we refer to it, because that's commonly referred to as prostitution. I think just by that label, it implies that they're making some choice and they're giving consent to the sort of abuse that's going on. And our experience is they have no choice, absolutely no choice.
He used to lock me in his house while I went out to work. He made me destroy all my phone numbers and addresses. He was angry all the time and he'd hit or kick me for any reason. I thought that was all I was worth.
This is a group room where they can listen to music or just be themselves, really.
This can be literally the only safe space where girls like Carol can speak freely.
He would have killed me if I'd have told the police.
I think it's a sad reflection on a society that a man can wind down the window and ask for sex with a 12-year-old and not be frightened or ashamed that he's actually doing something that is not acceptable. I would say quite clearly it is not okay and it's not acceptable in our society for men to purchase sex from children.
Workers at the project are campaigning for a change in the law to ensure these girls are treated as abused children. Their sophistication is all veneer. At present, laws dating back to the 1950s ensure that they are treated as common prostitutes, which implies informed consent. Sarah questions whether the consent of a 13-year-old should be seen in law as identical to that of a 30-year-old. As the law stands, she says that the child is not only sexually assaulted, she is then arrested. The curb crawler is not. To change their lifestyle can be difficult, and a century ago, the charity had a much more straightforward approach to what they called degradation. Boys who got involved in crime were also taught to be what Barnardo's called fine citizens. He did this by teaching them a trade like printing, shoemaking and carpentry.
He gave chase at 100 miles an hour before seeing the joyrider veer into the path of an oncoming lorry.
In the last series of Barnardo's Children, we saw in action today's attempts to reform a young criminal. Andrew Ellis was 17 at the time and a perpetual joyrider. He was facing a term in jail when he agreed to a different sentence. Sessions at the Barnardo's Community Options Scheme in Cardiff. Project leader Helen Jones tried to make him face the consequences of his actions.
All right. Let's get on the inboxing.
All
Casualties from another road accident come through the door.
Okay, sweetheart. Right, Johnny.
Oh, well, Johnny.
That's
it. Let it relax.
Just put your leg down, sweetheart.
Right, we'll go and get
How old are you? Three. And what happened?
A car hit you. Where did it hit you? On the road.
Were you crossing the road?
All right.
With hindsight, Andrew now puts his life of crime down to the emotional turmoil he suffered as a child when his parents split up. This might sound clichéd, but who is to judge?
It didn't affect my other brothers and sisters that much. It did affect them, like, but not that much. It was me who was the trouble one. I was the one who was always running away to try and get them two together and talk. When I was getting arrested, I was asking for my mother and my father to come down. And my mother turned around and said, is your father going down? I'd say yes. And she said, well, there you go. You've got someone to bail you out. I won't come down now.
Part of Andrew's punishment was to start reparation in the community. He arrived with Helen Jones on his first day at work at Cardiff Royal Infirmary.
I just had to go into the CRI, Cardiff Royal Infirmary, make beds, help with cups of teas, coffee for the patients, and that was it, in the hospital.
People often think this kind of programme is a soft option as an alternative to custody, but it's not. In some ways, it's actually more demanding, more difficult. It asks them to think about what they've done. But if we send a young person to prison or to youth custody, 80% of them will re-offend as soon as they come out.
Ever since Barnardo's Community Options 2 years ago, I haven't stole one car, no one car since. I have been pinching, but I haven't stolen a car. But then when I stopped going to Barnardo's, I was finding it hard to survive because I never had that much money. So I started doing house burglaries and then got arrested.
Andrew is about to become a father for the third time and is currently on probation for attempted burglary. Maybe things would have been different if he'd had a stable family. Certainly Mabel's life would have been happier if she hadn't been abandoned.
I wish that Madre and I had a mum and dad that we could look up to and be happy. But we didn't. At one stage we were told that her mother went off and left us. We were never told why or where she left us and who found us. You know, or anything. I mean, we wouldn't know that, would we? Some kind person had probably found us. I just don't know.
Oh, Mabel, here we are.
Mabel wanted to know why she and her twin sister Marjorie had been abandoned. And today she's making her second visit to the village to try and piece together her early life.
Yes.
Many people find it too much to take in the first time. And Joyce Grant is going through her admission history with her again.
And how many children in total were in the home?
25.
25 children.
You don't know why you came into Barnardo's at all?
No.
No.
Okay.
Okay. Well, maybe today we'll be able to open up a little bit about what might have happened.
Oh, I see. All right. Yes, yes.
So could we start off by having a read of your history? You've waited too long, I think. Waited some time.
No.
Okay. Right, here we go. Do you want to have a read of that, Mabel?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Mabel is discovering that her mother was an unmarried woman living with her parents who ran a sweet shop. She took in washing to eke out a poor living of 15 shillings a week, 10 of which went towards paying for the twins' upkeep in a foster home.
Yeah, there seems to be a lot of us though, don't they, Johnsons, if they're all the same as name as mine.
Yes, because what?
Many more than. I thought there was just nobody.
Right, yes, because here your mother's brothers,
mm-hmm.
And it seems from this there are two brothers who had five children between them.
Yes.
And you had an aunt.
Yeah.
Whose husband was a piano tuner.
Mm-hmm.
So you come from... There is a family. There was a family.
There was a family,
yeah.
Yes.
Okay. You were admitted to Barnardo's in...
Does it say why?
Why?
Why we were admitted?
It doesn't actually state there. I think Basically, it's because your mother was a single woman.
Oh, was she?
And she was living with her parents.
Oh, I see. Well, of course, we've never heard anything, so I didn't know anything.
No. Yes. You were admitted on the 10th of May, 1923, and you were age 9. Did you think you were that old?
No, I thought we were younger.
Yes.
But that must be right.
Yes, but it doesn't play with your memory in such because you were with foster parents at a very young age. Well, so that's why sometimes children can get that.
You see, the only foster parents I remember are those cruel ones.
Oh, right, OK.
In Newbury, Berkshire.
Right.
They're the only foster parents I can remember. Mm-hmm. I sort of can't remember before that.
Your mother's religion was the Church of England?
Oh, was it?
Yes.
Yes.
OK. Mm-hmm. And she's got a beautiful name, Letitia Mary Johnson.
But she was a single mum, was she?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
In Mabel's day, there was no one to listen to either her feelings of abandonment or stories of abuse. She was encouraged to forget. Today, people are encouraged to remember, and the emphasis of Barnardo's work is on counselling. This can be a long and painful process where trust must be gained, and the child is encouraged in a safe environment to talk about what has happened to them. The change from secrecy to openness is helping old wounds to heal.
I'm going to be seeing Karen shortly. She's a woman in her mid-30s who was sexually abused from the ages of about 11 to 15. She grew up in a household where both her parents were deaf, so it was a non-hearing household, and she communicated by signing and by lip reading. Every Saturday they used to go and visit her grandparents and the whole family would gather there. And her uncle still lived there and he kept pigeons. And every Saturday she would go down the pigeon loft with him. One day she went down the shed as usual and her uncle locked the door behind her. She was surprised at this but just carried on. And then he told her to get undressed. She was so shocked she did as she was told. And he told her to lie on a table that was in the pigeon loft. He then undressed and ended up wearing just a blue waistcoat, and then he raped her. And this procedure then happened every Saturday, and he told her that if she told anybody, he would kill her mother. And she believed him. It's difficult for all children to be able to tell an adult about what's happened to them because they don't have the words for it. But for Karen it was doubly difficult because just imagine how difficult it is to sign that you have been raped by your uncle. It was just, she just couldn't do it.
There is a complete reversal today of Barnardo's policy towards childcare. At one time they were largely concerned with the children's physical care, whereas today it is their emotional needs that shape their work. The charity no longer run children's homes, and counselling plays a large and important role. As well as working with young people, they also counsel adults, so that coming to terms with their own experiences can help them parent their own children.
When I was abused, I used to go off into my own world, into the country, and listen to the birds and the wind. And
so you were telling me about why it was difficult before to go in a restaurant or a pub or to the cinema. Why was that hard?
You have to be in a group of people, and a group of people to me was like loads and loads of pigeons.
All right. And what's a group of people to you like now when you walk into a restaurant or a pub?
A group of people.
Oh, wonderful.
They can't hurt me.
Wonderful. Can anything hurt you now?
No.
No. Okay. Just before you stopped counselling with me last time, those wonderful photographs you had done. Do you remember?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. And how wonderful you looked in those. Have you still got them?
Yes.
What significance have they got for you, Carol?
Well, for years feeling down and in like a shell of my own. Mm. I decided it's time I looked after me for a change. Right. And I decided that I would go and have my photograph taken.
So you were looking after yourself, yeah. And how important was it to look really nice? Because on the photographs you'd had your makeup done and got gorgeous clothes on.
It was nice to be pampered.
Nice to be pampered.
Because I've never had that before.
And how do you see the future, Karen? Are you looking forward to it?
Yeah, whole new beginning, whole new world. Everything's different.
In the past, society denied that this sort of thing went on. It was kept secret, and children were left to suffer. Gemma was sexually assaulted from the ages of 2 to 8 years old. It has taken 5 years for her to regain the confidence in herself to express her anger at the man who abused her and who has since been released from prison.
I was very angry that he only got 1 year because, you know, my feelings and my hurt went on for a lot longer than 1 year. And it's just so heartbreaking to know that somebody got away with 1 year and then came out, and then still having the fear of him coming round and maybe doing it again, or maybe doing it to another child, because it's, if you've done it once, then you're likely to do it again. I was very depressed after he came out of prison. And I was just torn apart. I didn't know how to feel anymore. I didn't have any feeling. I didn't know what to do with myself. And if I hadn't got the help from Barnardo's, I wouldn't have been here. I would have killed myself a long time ago. The first time I saw Kath, it was like a whole new experience. It was like everything had just been taken off my shoulders. And all my problems, I just told her everything. It just felt a whole lot better. And I'd felt happy for the first time in my life after I'd walked out them doors. I've got a lot more confidence now. I can go out shopping, which I just couldn't do. I can do anything that anybody else can do, which other people just take for granted. And other people just go out and do. But I had to learn all over again how to do it, which took a lot of time and a lot of courage.
For Pat Goodwin, who grew up here, it has also been a case of having the courage to face her pain in order to heal it. She returned to Farm Hill, her original Barnardo's home, 2 years ago for a reunion. We filmed her watching archive footage of herself for the first time, and she was not prepared for the impact this was to have.
When I walked down the driveway, I could feel all the sadness and everything closing in on me. And I felt quite lonely, really. I remembered when I started fantasizing about my mother, what she was like, why didn't she want me? And one day, maybe she might come and get me and look after me and care for me. There were a lot of unanswered questions. It fed me with the desire to find out about my mother, and in the hope that she was going, I was going to find something in my records that she cared about me in some little way. You know, it would have made all the difference. When I came to Barkingside to see my records, I wanted to see whether or not there was any hope of her ever caring, or writing to Barnardo's or asking about me anyway. When there wasn't, I was slightly disappointed, but you have to face up to the fact that there may not be anything in there. And I could let go. I could let go of the hope, that hope. I actually know now that I have a right to be a person as much as anybody else. You know, that I have a family and I'm a person now.
Many children's organisations took part in a migration scheme, and Barnardo's sent over 30,000 young people to start a new life in Canada and Australia. In 1928, Mabel and Marjorie's names were put on the list to be sent overseas, but Mabel wasn't fit to travel.
I was ill, I couldn't go, and I asked them if they would let Marjorie stay with me until I could go with her. I said, couldn't Marjorie stay with me until I was better? And then when the next lot of girls went out, we could have gone out together. But they wouldn't listen to me. They just said that her name was on the list and she had to go. And, you know, I missed her so much. And I know she did me. And I think for the rest of my life, I will still wonder why they did it. Why they could have been so cruel to have done it, if you like, yes. Yeah. Because it was cruel, you couldn't say anything else, could you? I have a photograph of Marjorie that was taken just before she boarded the boat to go to Australia. I always kiss her goodnight. Yeah. Because I loved her so much. Yeah.
Photographs are treasure indeed when that is all one has left of a loved one. Like Mabel, Bernadette and her sister and brothers also have precious objects to cherish.
This is my favourite cuddly toy out of everything I've got. It's what my mum bought me when I was 9, 10 years old. I think it's just because I've had it so long and it's what my mum bought me. The favourite thing in mine is this chain that my mum wore.
You've got the photos in yours?
Yeah, a few.
Yeah.
I can find them, I'll show you one.
That one?
That one.
And
a mug what I bought my mum for her last birthday she had with us. Told us not to use it, it had to stay in the cabinet. She says she loved it.
This picture is of mum and me when she was in hospital. She used to always smile when we came and she wasn't expecting us. She used to come up without a knowing sometimes and then she gets a nice surprise and then she starts being happy and that.
These special things I look at just normally when things go wrong. And when I think about my mum, this week mum would have been 37. Which was a second birthday we've had without her. Which is sad, really, because we can't get her a present apart from flowers or a wreath to put on a grave and a birthday card. Mum left us a poem, which I found a couple of days after she died. When I am sad and lonely and the night is drawing nigh, that's when my memories come to me, I sit alone and cry.
I've always put a smile on, that's only been a show.
But now the end is drawing near, I've tried to do my best. I've loved you all, one by one, I think I've earned a rest. Good night and God bless, Mum.
The same project in Leeds also supports families where there is a sick child. 360,000 children in the country currently have disabilities, and they often need a lot of physical and moral support. In 1995, we filmed Terence, who was then 11. Counsellor Devora Mark spent time with both Terence and his mother, Mandy.
The difficulties have been, with the last one or two operations, haven't there? There have been real difficulties using the other methods that they were hoping would work for Terence.
Yeah, well, 2 months ago when he had treatment, they nicked a vein in his abdomen, so it caused him to hemorrhage. And Terence were very poorly, very down.
Terence suffers from a rare condition called Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome. In our earlier film, we saw Devora spend many months with Terence, gaining his confidence. This moment was a breakthrough in their relationship.
I know a little bit, that was it the last operation you had round about Christmas time? There was a bit of difficulties there, weren't there? Yeah.
I just woke up and my belly pains everywhere.
Did you?
I didn't know what time I was down in the recovery room. I thought I was only down for once and I was down twice.
You went down, you had to go down again, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh, right.
I was supposed to watch the Man United match, but I was fast asleep.
Gosh, you missed that.
The Castle Project is still offering support to Terence and Mandy.
Since we were last filmed, Terence has been back down to London. He's now had between 11 and 13 operations over the years. I have been housed into a disabled unit. Also, he has a new electric wheelchair, which it gives Terence the independence of going out and about by himself, up to shops. I don't have to go with him. I don't keep nothing from Terence now. He's 13, and because he's 13, I feel that he should take some of the responsibility on and know what is going on.
When are you going down to London next?
March. Take the rest of my leg off.
Yeah.
So, a bit nervous, but sure, then.
What was
that, green?
Yeah, green.
It's 4 points. Probably down there for a couple of weeks, I think, in London.
Yeah.
So, it's a fair bit of school work.
You better catch up.
Well, yeah, probably. Just get it up into the shop.
Terence has since had his operation and is back home and recovering well. Since its foundation, the charity has seen huge changes from institutional care to working with whole communities living in the most poor and run-down areas. Children are at the heart of everything they do, and today the charity runs over 250 projects throughout the United Kingdom that tackle the problems young people face and work towards helping them find a better future. Soon, the village will house a heritage centre, and the memories of those who grew up there will live on. After the first series of Barnardo's Children, many people wanted to know whether Mabel had ever got to meet her sister again.
I hadn't seen her for 60 years. And, I mean, she used to write to me a lot. But then she became ill, and I had the feeling that she was ill, because she didn't write. Anyway, it got around in Hayward's Heath that, you know, I would love to see her. I just don't think I will ever forget what came of it. I mean, first of all, the British Airways put up £500 towards my fare, and then an anonymous lady from Chichester put up another £500, so I went up first class. It were my friends from Croydon, they come to see me off. And the number of the plane came up and they said, "This is it, Mabel. you're now going. And I got halfway across that hall and I ran back to them. I didn't want to go. I ran back to them. But anyway, an air hostess came out and she said, oh, you'll be all right, we'll take care of you. So away I went and the plane started and I just couldn't believe I was going to see Marjorie. When I got there, I saw this lady standing over by the fence. And we both seemed to look up at the same time. And we looked at each other. And she came straight across. I had no way of knowing that she would know that was me after all those years. But she came straight across to me and put her arms on my neck and hugged me and kissed me. And naturally, I did the same for her. But then, you see, we went home, and then the next morning, it was so different, because when she saw me, she said, who are you? What are you doing in my house? You don't live here. She completely forgotten that I was her sister. You see, she had Alzheimer's disease. But I think in the main, I told myself before I came back that in the main, I think she did. I think she did know me. After I got back, I heard that she died. And I was so very, very grateful that I'd been given the chance to see her while she was still alive, even if she wasn't always sort of with me, you know. But at least I had seen her. And that was all I wanted. Yeah.
If you'd like help or information regarding anything you've seen in this programme, please call the helpline number 0800 767 800. It's open now until 12:30 tonight and again tomorrow during the day from 10 till 4.